everyone. Welcome back to integralcalc.com. Today we're going to be doing another volumes by cylindrical shells problem. And in this problem, we're given two functions, y squared equals x and x equals 2y. And they've asked us to actually find the area in between these two functions when both functions are rotated around the y-axis. So a couple interesting things to note with this problem. First of all, we're going to be using the same formula that we always use for volumes by cylindrical shells when we're rotating around the y-axis. And everything is the same here. You'll notice that we have the x here in the formula, which indicates that we're rotating around the y-axis. And we're going to have our function here, and that's going to be something interesting to pay attention to. But oftentimes with a problem like this, we'll be given a range on which we're evaluating from A to B, and we use those values to plug in here for our limits of integration, A and B. But in this case, we're not given A and B, so the first thing that we need to do is find them ourselves, and then once we do, we can plug them in, set up our integral, and we'll be able to simplify and solve. So the first thing we want to do is find A and B, like I said, and the way that we're going to do that is we're going to solve both of these equations for y and then set them equal to one another. So if you look at the first equation here, to solve this first equation, y squared equals x for y, we'll want to take the square root of both sides to make this exponent here go away. So when we take the square root of both sides, taking the square root of y squared will just simply give us y, and then we'll be left with the square root of x over here on this side. So you can see that that's what we have over here, y equals the square root of x. Solving this equation for y, if we just divide both sides by 2, that will also leave y on its own, so we'll be left with y equals x divided by 2, and you can see we've done that here with our second equation. So now that we've solved both of them for y, now that we know that the square root of x is equal to y, and that x over 2 is equal to y, we can set the square root of x equal to x over 2, and simplify this equation here to solve for x. And this will actually give us the points at which these two functions intersect one another. So we solve this function for x, or this equation for x, by first multiplying both sides by 2. I think this is the easiest way. So we multiply both sides by 2, and then we divide both sides by the square root of x. Now remember that the square root of x is the same thing as x to the 1/2. So you can see from here that I divided both sides by the square root of x and I just changed it automatically to x to the 1/2 instead of the square root of x because they're the same thing, but it'll make the next step easier. So we go ahead and divide by the square root of x, and now notice that we have, this is basically x to the 1, right? That 1 is implied as an exponent. We have x to the 1 over x to the 1/2. And whenever you have whenever you have a fraction and you have the same base in the numerator and the denominator, in our case our base is x, you can subtract the exponent in the denominator from the exponent in the numerator. So we're going to subtract 1/2, this exponent, from 1, which is the implied exponent in the numerator. So we'll have 1 minus 1/2 is 1/2. So we end up with, or this right side here simplifies to x to the 1/2. So we're left with that. And now we want to get x by itself. So we go ahead and we square both sides, because if we take, if we square x to the 1/2, we will end up multiplying 1/2 by 2, and the 2's will cancel, be left with x to the 1, in other words, just x, and that's how we can solve for x. So we square both sides. 1/2 times 2 equals 1, so we get x to the 1 over here equals 4. So we found the point at which our two functions intersect one another, but remember, we need two points at which they intersect. So we know they intersect at 4, but we need another point. And if we go back up here and we look, you can see 0 is usually a good bet to try, like 0 or 1, especially if you're in calculus 2. It's, you know, if you've got 4, 0 or 1, and if we look up here and we plug in 0 for x to both equations, right, If we plug in 0 here, we'll get y equals the square root of 0. In other words, y equals 0. And if we plug in 0 to this equation, we'll get y equals 0 over 2. And of course, that's y equals 0. So we know, we can prove that 0 is also a point at which they intersect. And another way that you can look at that is by graphing the two equations here. So if you graph the two equations, you'll see you have y equals the square root of x in purple and y equals x over 2 in orange. Here's our point of intersection at 4. You can also see that they intersect at 0. So if you're not sure, you can graph them on your calculator and find the points of intersection or verify them that way. So we know that our functions intersect at 0 and 4. So we've gone ahead and we've plugged in the limits of integration 0 and 4. Now, we leave 2 pi x because that's part of our formula here, but we have to plug in for f of x. And normally, in a volumes by cylindrical shells problem, we're simply given one function and told, you know, rotate it around the y-axis between x equals 1 and x equals 4. And we have this one function and we plug in our one function in place of f of x in our formula. In this case, they've asked for the area between the two graphs. So what we have to do is we need to graph them and look at which one is higher or above the other one. In this case, you can see that y equals the square root of x in purple is above y equals x over 2 in orange. You can see that it's higher than or above the other graph. So what we need to do is take the function that's higher, which is the square root of x, and subtract from that the lower function, which is x over 2. So instead of just plugging in one function here for f of x, we take the higher function and subtract from that the lower function, and that'll give us the area in between the two graphs. If you don't have access to a graphing calculator and you can't graph them, you've already found your limits of integration 0 and 4. Just pick any point between 0 and 4, 1, 2, or 3, for example. Plug them in to both of your equations and see which one is higher, and that will be the greater function. So you'll know that that one here goes first, and then you subtract the lower function. So that's another way to do it. So now we've set up our integral, and we're going to go ahead and start simplifying this so that we can integrate. And the first thing we're going to do is distribute this x. So we end up with x times the square root of x minus x times x over 2. And now we're going to go ahead and multiply these together. Again, here, x times the square root of x, we have like bases of x and x. This first one here is x to the 1 power, right? And the second one here, the square root of x, is x to the 1/2 power. So when we have like bases and they're multiplied together, we add the exponents. So we have 1 here plus 1/2 is 1 1/2 or 3/2. So we end up with x to the 3/2 power. This term, obviously, we have an x squared over 2. I've gone ahead and separated the coefficient, which is the 1/2, from the x squared to make it a little bit simpler. So that's about as far as we can simplify our integral. We also moved the 2 pi out in front because it's a constant and it's a coefficient on all of these variables, so we can just bring it out in front of the integral to save ourselves some hassle. So now we're going to go ahead and integrate, and what that looks like, of course, we'll add 1 to 3/2 and we get 5/2, and then we divide the coefficient on this x term, which is 1, it's implied and not written, but it's a 1. We divide the 1 by the new exponent, which is 5/2, so for this coefficient we end up with 1 divided by 5/2, which 1 divided by any fraction is going to simplify to the inverse of that fraction, so we end up with a 2/5 out here in this coefficient. And then same thing here, we add 1 to the exponent and we get 3, and then we divide our coefficient 1/2 by the new exponent 3, and we get 1/6. So we have 1/6 here, x to the third, and we're going to be evaluating between these limits of integration 0 and 4. So let's go ahead and evaluate this definite integral here. Remember with a definite integral when we're evaluating, we always plug in the top number, which was 4, to our whole function, and then always subtract here in the middle, and then plug in our bottom number, which you'll remember was 0. So we plug that into our function as well. And now it's going to be a lot of arithmetic to simplify. But what we'll end up with in the front here, this simplifies to 64 fifths. This simplifies to 32 thirds. And then, of course, you see we have 0 multiplied here in this first term and 0 in the second term. So this whole thing here is going to become 0. So we'll end up with 2 pi times 0. And when we simplify one more step, obviously this second term goes away completely. 64 fifths minus 32 thirds, we find a common denominator of 15, and we end up with 32 fifteenths. When we multiply that by 2 pi, we get our final answer, which is 64 pi over 15. So what this tells us is that the area, when we rotate these two functions here, both of them around the y-axis, the area that's created between those two curves is 64 pi over 15. So I hope that video helped you guys, and I'll see you in the next one.